whistleblower complaint that we received, or at least we had an opportunity to review last night, but only received today. We made available to the public as soon as we received the redacted version. Sets out a series of the most damning allegations concerning the conduct of the president and others potentially within the administration. In that, it lays out a scheme to use the leverage of the presidency, use the leverage of the vital military assistance to a foreign nation to provide or obtain dirt on a political opponent. It's hard to imagine a more serious set of allegations than those contained in the complaint. The complaint goes further, obviously, than the record of the call, in that it also alleges that there were efforts made to conceal this scheme by moving communications onto servers that were designed for an entirely different purpose, that were designed, in fact, to contain communications of covert action and other highly sensitive and compartmented intelligence information. It is a deep irony that the Department of Justice would say this is outside of the jurisdiction of the Director of National Intelligence, and yet someone felt that this should be put in the place that is used for the protection of the most sensitive of classified information. But what we do know at this point is this, that when the Inspector General found that this whistleblower was credible, he was right. Because what this whistleblower said about the nature of that call has been borne out in great detail by the call record that has now been released. So in a very substantial part, this whistleblower has already been found to be credible. Whether the other allegations that go beyond this specific call will be borne out has yet to be determined, and that it will be the subject of our investigation. This whistleblower has given us a roadmap for our investigation, but it's important to underscore that what we are able to corroborate already about the whistleblower has been corroborated in detail by this record of the president's conversation with the president of Ukraine. That gives added weight and urgency to the need to get to the bottom of the other allegations that are made by the whistleblower. And once again, I want to express my profound gratitude to the whistleblower for coming forward. And I'm grateful for the director for coming to the committee, for not requiring us to use coercion. Now, yes, we provided a subpoena, but nonetheless, he came before our committee, and he came before the committee voluntarily. And while I believe that he has made the wrong decision in withholding the complaint, like my colleagues, I respect his service to the country. But we are profoundly concerned with the breakdown of this whistleblower system that has been manifest over the last month, that a whistleblower who was deemed credible, who had a complaint that was deemed urgent, that a complaint that was intended to come to Congress would be withheld to Congress, and would be withheld on the basis of advice given by the subject or subjects of that complaint. The conflict of interest is all too apparent, all too palpable. It is indeed a minor miracle that we got the complaint at all and that we got the transcript at all. At the end of the day, what is alleged in this whistleblower complaint goes to the very heart of the president's oath of office, that he faithfully execute the laws of the country, that he defend the Constitution, and if, as this record of call already indicates, the president was, instead of faithfully executing his office, was using that office as leverage to obtain dirt, to have another country manufacture dirt on his opponent, it is hard to imagine a more fundamental abuse of that office. And so we are determined to get to the bottom of this, and I'm happy to respond to a couple of questions.
Not speaking to the whistleblower, what are your next investigative steps? What targets emerge from reading this complaint and from the hearing today you are going to do, and what's the timeline on which you're hoping to work? Obviously, recess begins on Friday for the next couple of weeks.
We'll be working through the recess, and as I mentioned, I think the complaint gives us a pretty good roadmap of allegations that we need to investigate. There is a whole host of people apparently who have knowledge of these events, that the whistleblower makes reference to. Now, we don't know how many or any of them that have already been interviewed by the Inspector General. We will be having a subsequent hearing with the Inspector General, which we have requested, so that we can determine what he was able to find in his preliminary investigation. Now, he had only 14 days to do it, but it looks like he did a far more substantial investigation than anything the Justice Department was apparently willing to do. And so we will see what witnesses have been interviewed and which haven't. We'll do our best to identify those. We're obviously going to be bringing the whistleblower in, and I was pleased that the director committed to having the whistleblower come in as soon as the clearance issues are resolved for the whistleblower's counsel, and that we have the commitment of the Director of National Intelligence that there will not be some minder from the White House or the Department of Justice or anywhere else that is instructing him what he can and cannot answer or what she can or cannot answer. That further testimony will help identify, I hope, some of these other individuals that can corroborate these deeply troubling allegations. We also want to determine what the documentary evidence is. We need to look into the allegation that this may not be the only communication of a potentially corrupt character that was shielded by this classified information computer system abused for that purpose. We want to know what role Rudy Giuliani had in all of this. We want to know what role Bill Barr had in any of this. We want to know what Ukraine understood was expected of them before they even had this July phone call with the President of the United States. So we know what we have to do, and of course, we'll be guided by the evidence that we find along the way.
What potential crimes do you see in the complaint?
I'm sorry?
What potential crimes do you see?
Well, yeah, look, I think there are any number of potential crimes when a president is soliciting foreign assistance again in another presidential election. There can be no claim of ignorance this time. When a president is withholding authorized funding of Congress to use as leverage, if the president were involved in somehow extorting a foreign nation to dig up or manufacture dirt on his opponent, if there's an effort to cover up any of this conduct, there are innumerable potential offenses, but I have no confidence that this Justice Department, led by this Attorney General, will investigate anything except the President's adversaries or claims that give a fodder to the conspiracy theories which the President wishes to peddle, which indeed the President was peddling with President Zelensky. And so as the Inspector Generals appear not to have jurisdiction, according to the Department of Justice, to look into this, as the Department is unwilling to look into this, this will fall within our responsibility.
Will you specifically seek interviews with Rudy Giuliani, with Bill Barr, and will you subpoena for those transcripts that were allegedly stored that were separate from this individual phone?
I'm not going to get into specific investigative steps at this point, but as I made clear in the questions I had for the director today, I think each and every one of these allegations, given their seriousness, given that no one is looking into this and no one has been apart from this committee for the last month, that these urgent matters need to be thoroughly investigated. Now, we are going to move as expeditiously as possible. Of course, it's been the history of this administration prior to this very graphic exception of the publishing of this call record and the provision of the complaint, the declassification of the complaint, that this administration has attempted to obstruct our inquiry in any way and in every way. But we will be working to conduct this as swiftly as possible.
Chairman Schiff,
we're going to head back into this room.
Okay. President Trump just tweeted about you, saying that you have zero credibility, another fantasy to hurt the Republican Party. How do you respond?
Well, I'm always flattered when I'm attacked by someone of the president's character. Thank you.
Do you believe that the DOJ did discuss this case with the president?